This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
For an international conference to revive Middle East peace talks, and George Bush has wasted no time in seeking support for his vision. The U.S. president has telephoned leaders of Saudi Arabia, Jordan, and Egypt, urging them to back his plan and to support Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas. It was all outlined in this speech from the White House. The U.S. president called for a new international summit to involve Israel and its Arab neighbors sometime in the coming months. He also announced $80 million in new U.S. aid to the interim Palestinian government to reform security services. And he demanded Arab states reject what he called the violent extremism of Hamas.
This is a moment of clarity for all Palestinians. And now comes a moment of choice. The alternatives before the Palestinian people are stark. There is the vision of Hamas, which the world saw in Gaza, with murderers in black masks and summary executions and men thrown to their death from rooftops. By following this path, the Palestinian people would guarantee chaos and suffering and the endless perpetuation of grievance. They would surrender their future to Hamas's foreign sponsors in Syria and Iran. And they would crush the possibility of any of a Palestinian state.
Well, the response from Hamas has been to call on the Muslim and Arab world to face what it describes as Bush's crusade.
What type of help? I think the help will be help the Israeli to attack the more on the Palestinian target, especially in Gaza Strip. We don't believe that he is changing his mind. Nobody can forget the campaign in under the title of Crusades. Nobody can neglect the bloodshed in Afghanistan and in Iran. Nobody can trust his policy in the other area in the international global communities, whether starting from North Korea, passing to Afghanistan, Pakistan, interference, and also in Iraq, Somalia, and others, especially in Palestine. Mr. Bush is trying to play a public relationship policy because he is in urgent need in the expected few months for the strong Zionist lobby money and political support.
Meanwhile, Israeli cabinet ministers are set to announce the list of Palestinian prisoners to be released this week in a move to improve relations in the region. David Chaser reports.
The list of Palestinian prisoners slated to be released will be published today to give Israelis 48 hours to challenge the decision before they're freed at the end of this week. Most of the prisoners are from Fatah, but they also include members of the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine and the Democratic Front.
We hope that this will add more momentum in the process which has already started between Israel and the Palestinians.
The cabinet go-ahead for the release came in the wake of President Bush's special address in Washington, in which he announced new support for the Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas and condemned Hamas as murderers in black masks. But political analysts in the West Bank say his attempt to isolate Hamas will in the end be frustrated by Washington's main allies in the region.
I think it is in the objective interests of Egypt and Saudi Arabia at some point to try to mend the situation and bring both sides together.
On the streets of Ramallah, the response to Washington's new measures of support and the calling of an international conference this autumn was lukewarm.
He's saying that he's encouraging Abu Mazen, but he's encouraging him against Hamas. And Hamas is part of Palestinians.
Now the funding is coming back. The U.S. is saying, okay, we want to give you money, this, that, and the other. So obviously, he is a puppet, I'm sorry to say.
We need the guarantees from Quartet and especially for Mr. Bush to go further steps to real peace.
There's also been some disdainful reaction to the Bush speech inside Israel. As one analyst said, anyone who thinks a step towards peace can be taken without Hamas has made a bitter error. The Palestinian train has already left the station heading for Iran. Hamas is here to stay. David Chater, Al Jazeera, at the Qalandia checkpoint on the outskirts of Ramallah.
And joining us now from our Tel Aviv studio is the Prime Minister's International Media Advisor, Miri Eisen. Hi, Miri.
Good afternoon.
Mary, was Prime Minister Olmert pleased by the President's speech? After all, the idea of the international conference was actually Olmert's, was it not?
There's no question that the speech that we heard yesterday is the continuation of American policy as we've already understood it. We heard the open, incredible fact of fighting against terror, of sidelining Hamas, of concrete steps that need to be taken by both sides. We certainly heard things that we agree with, that we see eye to eye with. When it comes to the international meeting, Prime Minister Olmert has thought about such a meeting. He thinks it could be a very interesting venue to bring together moderate Arab countries, countries like Saudi Arabia, like Morocco, who could come and sit around and could talk and become an umbrella to really give momentum to the bilateral talks between Israel and the Palestinians.
Miri, do you have any indication whether countries like Morocco you mentioned or even Saudi Arabia will indeed participate?
We certainly would see that as a very interesting development. The Americans are the ones who are initiating the idea of a meeting. They haven't yet set where it would be or the exact time. But by opening it up with a very clear definition, all of those who recognize Israel's right to exist, it doesn't mean that they have to have formal diplomatic ties. Countries who accept clearly a two-state solution, Israel alongside Palestine, both in peace and security.
Right.
Those who accept the other. We think this could be a very big possibility.
Okay, let me ask you this. You mentioned the concrete steps that Israel was asked to make. President Bush has been asking Israel for 4 years now to dismantle illegal outposts. Not one of them has been removed. Is anything going to change now, do you think?
The basic government principles of the present coalition include very strongly the removal of the illegal outposts. This is part of this government's commitment. It will be done sooner rather than later. We have all noticed that Israel has gone through quite a turmoil time over the last year. There wasn't the right time. I think that we'll be seeing these things now taking and very concrete steps, not only on the issue of the illegal outposts as we know them, but concrete steps to build up confidence between us and the moderate Palestinians.
Let's talk about some of those steps. Today, the Ministerial Committee approved the release of over 250 Palestinian prisoners, and a member of the cabinet, Shaul Mofaz, said that no Israeli and Palestinian prisoner should be released until Hamas frees Gilad Shalit. Is there not something in that argument?
Today, the government took a courageous decision. They decided that they want to show openly that if you are a moderate, if you call for dialogue with Israel, if you're openly willing to talk about a two-state solution, that there is a benefit. These are 250 men, an additional 6 women. It is a brave decision which shows that we're willing to take risks, not impossible risks, but those that can take us closer to what we all want to hope for, a Palestinian state alongside Israel that will bring about peace and security for both sides. It is a very important decision, and there can be the expectation of continued evolving security relations between the Palestinians and Israel.
Miri Eisen, thank you so much for coming into IBA News today.
Thank you.
An Israeli ministerial committee has approved the Palestinian prisoners list, which is part of a goodwill gesture by Israel's Prime Minister Ehud Olmert. The list includes the names of 250 prisoners, mostly from the Fatah faction, as well as some from the Popular and Democratic Fronts for the Liberation of Palestine. The Israeli government said that it will publish the list over the web in order to allow Israeli citizens to review it and file any objection they may have with the Superior Court.
The last phase in what Israel described as a goodwill gesture has been completed. An Israeli ministerial committee has approved the release of 250 Palestinian prisoners, mostly from Fatah, as well as some from the Democratic and Popular Fronts. This news comes after the Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas met Israel's Prime Minister in West Jerusalem, where Olmert said that the release of the prisoners will begin as early as Friday. Israel believes that Olmert's move will help strengthen the Palestinian Authority of Mahmoud Abbas.
It is in Israel's interest to strengthen Abu Mazen in order to give him an opportunity to build his authority in the West Bank with the hope that he will be able to regain control of Gaza in the future. I think the decision to release 250 Palestinian prisoners, mostly from Fatah, was a good move.
In contrast, what do Palestinians think of the list?
In formulating the list, the Israelis chose the names of those prisoners who are serving short prison term sentences or those who have already served more than two-thirds of their sentences. They are talking about those who received prison term sentences ranging between 3, 5, or 8 years, and this is not acceptable by the Palestinians.
Just like any other previous gestures, this Israeli pardon applies to those prisoners who received limited prison term sentences. The number in the prisoners' list is very small in proportion to the total number of Palestinians held in Israeli jails. Nearly 11,000 Palestinians, including some who have been locked up for more than 20 years, are currently held in the more than 30 Israeli jails and detention centers. In addition, among the prisoners are some with illnesses as well as some children and women, including some who have given birth in prisons. Moreover, the number includes the names of political leaders and former Palestinian ministers and parliament members. More than 40,000 Palestinians, including 3,000 children and 200 young women, have been detained since the Palestinian Intifada erupted in 2000. Since then, Israel has been carrying out daily sweeps and home raids in the Palestinian territories. Human rights organizations often spoke of the types of tortures, including physical and psychological, inflicted on Palestinian prisoners. Such torture, which Israel has legitimized, contradicts the UN Anti-Torture Treaty. In order to punish the prisoners, Israel sometimes takes actions against their families and properties. More than 150 Palestinians have died in Israeli prisons since the occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip in 1967. Since then, Israel has detained more than 650,000 Palestinians, or nearly 20% of the total Palestinian population, meaning that every Palestinian family may have tasted the bitterness of abduction.
The blood of Kirkuk's victims had barely dried up when another explosion took place today, killing 29 people, including women and children. The attack was carried out in Dweila in northeastern Baquba by unknown armed men who were wearing military uniforms. In a separate incident, a booby-trapped vehicle exploded in the parking lot of the Iranian embassy in Baghdad, killing 4 people. A third explosion was caused by a suicide bomber who detonated his booby-trapped car in the heart of Baghdad. The residents of northern Kirkuk mourned their dead as dozens of them went to hospitals to receive the remains of their sons and relatives who died yesterday in the double suicide explosion which killed 185 people and injured dozens of others. The Syrian President Bashar al-Assad gave a speech today in the parliament after he was sworn in for another seven-year term. He said that the solution to what is happening in Iraq comes through reconciliation among Iraqis and the setting of a timetable for the withdrawal of the occupation forces. Most importantly, he said that Syria will not enter peace negotiations with Israel without guarantees that Israel withdraws from the Golan Heights.
What is demanded of the Israeli officials is to make an official, clear, and unambiguous announcement about their desire for peace. They said that they will not negotiate with Syria, and then they sent secret letters to us. This is unacceptable. First, they must make a clear and serious announcement. Second, they must provide guarantees that all the occupied territories will be returned. We can't enter into negotiations with Israel about something we don't know. To begin with, we don't trust them. Our past experiences have damaged our confidence in them. Our negotiations and political experiences with them are not reassuring at all. Thus, the minimum demand we ask of them is that they provide a guarantee like Rabin's commitment or something in writing to assure us that the negotiations will not just be about the land, because the land will be restored to us, but rather about security measures.
At the Nahr al-Bared refugee camp, military confrontations continued between the Lebanese army and Fatah al-Islam. Armed fighters continued to launch Katyusha missiles on areas surrounding the camp. Also, some Fatah al-Islam fighters surrendered today.
A huge explosion shook the eastern part of Nahr al-Bared camp at exactly 7:10. This building, which was exploded by the Lebanese army, signaled the launch of military operations in the Safouri neighborhood. In the past few days, the Lebanese army was able to take over control of all the outskirts of the old camp. The military operations can be summed up by the following. On one side, army units are putting pressure on all the access points in the southeastern and southwestern areas, as well as the new camp facing the old one. On the other side, the army is exploding many buildings on the front lines because they pose a danger to its soldiers, or they are booby-trapped with a network of explosive devices. This caused fires to erupt and forced Fatah al-Islam to retreat and be surrounded in the center of the old camp, where violent clashes erupted throughout the day with medium and lightweight weapons. Lebanese army tanks continued to provide cover with intense fire, which allowed these units to advance. The army was able to take full control of Nahr al-Bared's periphery in preparation for improving the front lines after removing the rubble. This had allowed them to open a safe passageway to the center of the old camp. The latest information indicates that the army has also taken control of the Sasa Hill and the Zaatar neighborhood. Information coming from inside the camp indicates that some members of Fatah al-Islam have been killed and wounded. Also, some families who are still inside want to surrender to the Lebanese army. Members of Fatah al-Islam have been surrounded between the Safouri neighborhood and the security zone, which was under Fatah forces' control before they were expelled last week. But this has not prevented the terrorists from continuing their aggression against civilians outside Nahr al-Bared. They launched 107-millimeter mortar shells on villages surrounding the camp in the north. A number of these shells landed on the coast, while many others landed on greenhouses, causing some material damages. No human losses were reported. The violent clashes inside Nahr al-Bared camp did not spare the Lebanese soldiers. We learned that two Lebanese army soldiers were martyred and many others were wounded. LBC obtained exclusive information indicating that two members of Fatah al-Islam surrendered to the Lebanese army on Monday evening. They remain under investigation and are undergoing interrogation in order to obtain more information about the remaining members, especially the leaders among them.
أحييكم من جديد. أفاد مراسل العربية في شمال
An Al Arabiya correspondent in northern Lebanon has reported that the Lebanese army has taken full control of the old camp, with the exception of a small neighborhood that links the old and the new parts of the camp. Some members of Fatah al-Islam are still held out inside. Meanwhile, information from Lebanon indicates that one of the leaders of Fatah al-Islam, known as Abu Huraira, has finally been killed during clashes between the Lebanese army and members of Fatah al-Islam in Nahr al-Barid refugee camp. More details with our correspondent, Adnan Gamoush.
دخلت معركة نهر البارد بين الجيش اللبناني ومسلحين
The Nahr al-Barid battle between the Lebanese army and Fatah al-Islam armed fighters has entered a phase of many losses. The total defeat of the camp is just a matter of time. The military picture has become clearer. Most of Fatah al-Islam's military posts have fallen, and the Lebanese flag has been raised on the rooftops of the destroyed buildings in the heart of the camp. The remaining Fatah al-Islam fighters have been surrounded in the area that is located north of the main street, in the heart of Nahr al-Barid camp, specifically on the periphery of the Taqwa Mosque, passing through the Abu Hajar neighborhood. A Lebanese military source confirmed that the remaining Fatah al-Islam fighters have now been surrounded on all sides, and that they have no other choice than to surrender or die. What was notable about this was that two armed fighters surrendered during the confrontations. Information indicates that most leaders of the organization have been killed, including Shahab al-Qadur, who is known as Abu Huraira. Another source said that the leader of the organization, Shakar al-Absi, was severely wounded. Contacts between the Lebanese army and the Popular Front General Command succeeded in transferring an official from the Popular Front, Abu Nabil Baytoum, out of the camp and into the hands of the Lebanese army.
For the past 3 days, ever since our brothers in the other factions had left, the leaders of the army and the leaders of the Popular Front coordinated efforts to secure the safe exit of our companion Abu Nabil from the camp. We negotiated for the release of Abu Nabil, and he did indeed leave Nahr al-Barid refugee camp.
2 months after the confrontations began, there are signs of a certain victory. As the Nahr al-Barid battle winds to an end, relief appeared on the faces of the generals and soldiers of the Lebanese army. The Lebanese army's victory in this battle will reopen the door for the Lebanese-Palestinian dialogue, which will be the foundation for future Lebanese-Palestinian relations.
من على تخوم مخيم نهر البارد عدنا غموش العربية
أهلا بكم في إطار استعدادات تركيا لانتخاباتها النيابية في الثاني
Political observers have been paying a great deal of attention to the upcoming Turkish parliamentary elections, which will take place on the 22nd of July. National political parties have been engaged in a heated race to win the hearts of Turkish voters. Our correspondent in Istanbul has provided us with a report about the election campaign of the Justice and Development Party, which enjoys a great deal of popularity in Turkey.
The residents of Istanbul were receptive to the calls of Erdogan, the Prime Minister and the leader of the Justice and Development Party. They came in waves at the Dedişmelli Square to participate in the largest election campaign that the ruling party held in preparation for the parliamentary elections.
We're very content with the Justice and Reform Party. We're very appreciative. God willing, only good things will happen.
We have not seen any tax increases for the past 4.5 years. Everything is stable.
During the past 4 years, prices stayed the same.
The Reform and Justice Party, which was established 6 years ago, has managed to become the largest and most popular party in Turkey. Political observers agree that it has succeeded during its 5-year term in power in improving the political and economic conditions. Erdogan's slogan is one nation, one flag, one motherland, and one country. He is trying to gain more votes so he can stay in power without losing his wide authority.
We have great hope in you, people of Istanbul. We have unlimited confidence in you. Your city is an example for Turkey. This is how we know it. It is the city of peace and security. It is the city of civilization. The day of the elections will be a day to remember for both of us.
These people agree that the Justice and Reform Party has managed in a short period of time to achieve some of their hopes in the fields of health, education, taxes and others. They have decided to vote for this young party because its leaders still have a lot more to give. Although the ruling party enjoys a great deal of popularity, there are some groups who oppose it. Many people we asked said that the reasons that made them support the Justice and Development Party is that they had become tired of the old parties and had lost confidence in them. They have hope for this young party. The question is, how can Erdogan and his colleagues achieve the aspirations of these masses? For Al Madar program, Abdel Nasser Sanki, Abu Dhabi Television, Istanbul.
In a press conference, the Iraqi National Security Advisor, Dr. Muwaffaq al-Ruba'i, confirmed that nearly 160 Saudis accused of taking part in terrorist activities in Iraq have been put on trial, and hundreds of others are still awaiting their fate.
Al-Ruba'i said that a large number of those misled terrorists have infiltrated into Iraq from Saudi Arabia and other neighboring countries. He added that hundreds of those infiltrated were killed in suicide attacks, and many others were locked up in Iraqi prisons.
This wasn't the first time we heard this news, but its acknowledgement by the government was rather important. The fact of the matter is that many of the terrorist attacks launched in Iraq were carried out by armed groups that infiltrated into the country from neighboring Arab countries. The perpetrators often left behind trails of evidence pointing in that direction.
We had an agreement with our Saudi brothers in which to monitor the flow of money coming from the kingdom into Iraq, where it often ends in the hands of misled takfiris who use it to make explosive belts and plant roadside bombs to kill Iraqi civilians. Our brothers in Saudi Arabia have assured us that they will make it rather difficult to transfer money from the kingdom to Iraq. You must know that the money was pledged by civil organizations, private citizens and investors, and not by Saudi government or its institutions.
According to an Iraqi Interior Ministry source, the number of foreign terrorists arrested in Iraq has reached 2,489, and the number is indeed rising. This news has been confirmed by several Western media outlets and various local and foreign sources. Most of those arrested came from Saudi Arabia, Iran, Afghanistan, and Egypt.
Iraq is facing an international war. The terrorists who come from many countries continue to threaten Iraq's stability and the security of its people. The number of terrorists arrested by the Iraqi security forces has reached 2,489. While 1,335 suspects are still awaiting trials, 1,154 terrorists have been indicted on criminal charges.
Meanwhile, several senior Iraqi officials who stressed that they will not allow anybody to use Iraq as a ground to settle regional disputes warned that terrorism, if not stopped, may spread to neighboring countries. While it demanded countries in the region stop conspiring against Iraq, the Iraqi government urged its citizens to rally behind the National Unity and Reconciliation Initiative, as it is the only solution for their crisis. Sahar al-Ibrahimi, Iraqiya, Baghdad.
The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. Please visit linktv.org/mosaic for more information about these broadcasters or to view previous Mosaic programs, obtain program transcripts, or receive the weekly Mosaic Intelligence Report. Mosaic is made possible by a grant from the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. Additional support is provided by the Fyredahl Foundation, the Otto Haas Charitable Trust, and by committed Link TV viewers like you. If you value this program, please send your tax-deductible contribution to Link TV, either through the website or the mailing address listed on your screen. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.